We're ready to start our drawing. So we can go to File and either New and pick a template or Make Drawing from Assembly and pick our landscape third angle projection. Takes us into the view palette, or if it pops up on the model view on the property manager, we can pick the file. And I'll just go ahead and grab the isometric exploded and the isometric this time. We've been doing the copy and paste, and that little line should be an alignment line. So it'll move left and right, but then it will move with the parts. Now this bill of material is not going to be too big, but if we want to break alignment or add alignment, we can right click alignment, break, and then this will move independently again. So let's go to our annotation and do the auto balloon. And this time, that one's the square. And then if we do the round, the interesting one with the round is it always kind of throws everything out. But that will, with four parts, that will kind of surround it. We can manipulate those balloons if we don't like where they're going. If it goes to a face, then it will switch to a dot as opposed to the arrow. So if I place it on a face, we'll see the dot where default is set to do the pointers as an arrow. So as long as I'm picking that up, if I miss, then it goes to the question mark. It doesn't know what I'm selecting for. So it makes that it isn't attached to anything. And then we have the ghost images. So when the file will rebuild, those usually go away. Go into the bill of materials. And if I open the table, it went all the way to the languages. So I haven't set that in the options where I place that for my system files, but I can navigate. And we're doing top level only. If we get into assemblies, subassemblies, sub-subassemblies, then we'll want to look at the options for in the property manager. So our bill of materials isn't too complicated. So we probably wouldn't have to make those changes if we're using the template. All right, so next part, we can go to the view palette and insert a new. So we want the bracket. And we'll drag the bracket in as the front view. And advantage here is with the model view, we kind of take those three and the isometric as a default, and we may not need all of those. And then the isometric. Going through the view palette with the projected, though, you can kind of see which ones are going to be usable, which ones are going to be helpful to the build. So let's see what this looks like as a one-to-one. We're not filling up a lot of space. That certainly takes up quite a bit more, but we'll see if we can fit it in there. And we'll use a custom scale, and the isometric can be one. And some drawings will look at some of the rules. The isometric, and somewhere in here it says do not scale drawing. The isometric is going to be a little more difficult to dimension to and for reference only. So that would be one of the concerns. Hitting the S key, going into the smart dimension, we'll start to add our dimensions. And you want those to kind of line up, be close. So we're going to run out of room there. So depending on how I do this stack up, we'll determine where the tolerances are applied. So it should, most of the time, it will come out the same. But if I look at it from what happens if this can move plus or minus 5 thousandths or plus or minus 10 thousandths, and then this can move plus or minus 10 thousandths, and this can move plus or minus 10 thousandths, we have that stack up of tolerances that we would look at the function. Since there's so much open area here for the link, it's not really that much of a concern. So we'll place our dimensions, and the center mark is a little bit easier to grab. So we'll put those dimensions in place. We have all of those. And really, we're just positioning this so that it looks good and as a first iteration that we can go through and get to view. So on the drawings with more parts, typically we'll go through and set up all of the sheets and the views, and then come back and make a dimensioning pass, and then come back and make a tolerancing pass, and then a review so that we can determine which is the critical dimensions for this build. All right, so I'm not seeing, it must be in the annotations then. No, yep, hole call out. And because this is that advanced hole feature, it's saying to the far side, and it's basically saying going up to here, which is what we did on the definition. So if I wanted to change that to be through the near side, we'd have to go back and look at that call out. The cosmetic thread then doesn't necessarily go all the way around, kind of depends on the scale, and we'd have to look through the options to identify where those are coming in to see if that phantom line or hidden line that represents the cosmetic thread can be adjusted as far as its dash dash. So I'll insert the next one. We'll go to the drawing view. And pick the model, and then we can browse. So over time you'll adopt the your favorite, and really it comes down to a lot of times whichever one's closest, whichever one I'm thinking I want to work with. All right, so that's the top view, and we want to bring off a projected view. If I do the multiple views, then we can go ahead and accept. And as we move these around, get them a little closer into position. I don't know that a front view or the top view is going to be any better than the side view. I'm really just looking for something that will give me the thickness of the part. And so having that view doesn't really add anything to the mix. So we go into the smart dimensions. If I go hole location to hole location, if I want an overall, I can pick the arcs. All right, holding down the shift button, pick the first one, pick the second one, and that would be the same as picking the two arcs and coming over to the property manager, to the dimension manager, and picking our in conditions as center to center, minimum, or in this case, max, max. All right, because this is going to basically be a duplicate dimension, the hole centers are probably the more critical of the two dimensions. So this really becomes a reference dimension more for manufacturing that we're going to have something that is this long. And then back into the dimension, radius, and I'll do these as the hole call out again. So let's go back to annotations, hole call out. And if I just put the regular dimension on, we're going to not have that jog line. But if I put a regular dimension on, I'm going to have to manually put in the through. So if I click on that and then the on-screen dimension window, I can type in the through. All right, so whole callout, you're going to be able to tell the difference to how this was applied, mainly because of the leader and the verbiage, and then if something changed in the model, the through or to a blind or something along those lines, then we would have to go back and manually change that again. All right, so we're ready for the pins. So we have the insert. Let's see if we right click. So look down through here on the S key. We have the model view. All right, so again, a couple different ways to get through to our list. For this one, I'm going to bring in the M12 pin first, and we'll look at its orientation. And I'll drag one off to the side. And really, the up and down is not as effective of a use of. Go ahead and hit the OK. I thought I was getting the right mouse button. OK. The up and down isn't as an effective use of the paper. So if we click on the view and in the heads-up display, go to rotate view and tell it to go 90 degrees, then we apply it. If there's any dimensions, it will pretty much wipe those out, does not keep those. And then we're ready to start putting our dimensions. Also, it would be handy to have. So let's see, drawing views, projected. I'm not seeing the projected there right now. I'll go where I know I can find it. Projected view. It was probably right in front of me. And a right click to clear it. And then if I go to just the flat, it's not going to be the overall. And that one, grab the cosmetic thread and then grab the cosmetic thread again. So we'll make sure we're getting those lines. And I want this to be denoted as square. So we can put a square symbol in there. I don't know that that one's used as common. I would say the dimension is probably more likely to be in the drawing. So from the end to the tip, and then we want the thread depth. And can do notes if it makes it clear or adds to the mix. All right, and then we'll put the cosmetic thread. So with the cosmetic thread, there was that button that said show type. So if we go back in, let's get select and open the model in the upper left, and whichever one these cosmetic threads is in will identify it and edit the feature. If show type is on, then it's going to put in the machined thread. Well, that doesn't tell me as much or give me really any kind of information except to make this call out a lot longer. So I usually turn off the show type. And we'll make sure we're getting the outside. It goes to a radius because those are arc segments. But if I want that to go to the diameter, I can right click and display diameter or come back over to the leaders and display it as a radius or a diameter. Okay, so takes care of our peg. We'll do a little cleanup. Add one more for the M10. And I think I do have that habit of going to insert. So multiple views and the isometric, and this one happens to be in that orientation. We don't really need a left view here, so we'll just start dimensioning. So this one has the machine threads. So I'll go ahead and do a little bit more, and then there's a dimension that I missed. And if we wanted to, again, try that again. Not sure, I wasn't holding down the shift. I'm not sure what I was, I must have been the control. All right, so we'll make sure that we're in the select, open the part, and then expand out so we can identify the cosmetic thread, edit the feature. When I uncheck the show type and accept it, I didn't see a class, check the class on that real quick. Showing as a 1A. 2A is the most standard. Again, 1 is the loosest tolerance. If it's a dirty or corrosive environment, then the 1A and an open tolerance is better depending on the load and what we're trying to accomplish. 2A is going to be industry standard. 3 goes to a tighter fit. And anytime you make something a tighter tolerance, it also increases the cost. All right, so we've got those in. And then now we want to go back and pick up the chamfer. So S key, chamfer dimension, annotation, smart dimensions, chamfer dimension. One of those will get you there. And I always forget until after I've done it a couple times which I want to pick first, but you want to pick the angle and apply the and one of the adjacent edges so that it applies the chamfer. So again, right click, smart dimension, or more dimensions, chamfer. And the adjacent edge, and select. All right, so we'll make sure to save this, and that'll be our first pass. And we have the previous example, so this will be version 1. All right, so next pass will just be to view and a look over what did I miss, what can I improve, and it's through those iterations of as you're building the parts, thinking about what these are going to do, and then as you're putting them into the assembly, thinking about what these parts need to do, what could be the critical dimensions, and each pass then becomes a little bit more refined and a little bit closer to being a working model and drawing.